Hi, I'm Jeff Switovi, Business Unit Manager for Wachs Utility Products. I'm standing alongside our Standard LX valve maintenance trailer. The purpose of this video is to serve as an orientation. We're going to go over the various, the unpacking of the equipment, the proper setup, all the features included, as well as maintenance. So some of the things that you'll need in order to get your equipment ready for operation, a can of WD-40, a Phillips screwdriver, and a razor blade. You'll need all these are not shipped with the equipment, and you'll need them in order to prep the equipment for operation. Most trailers will come shrink wrapped, hence the reason you'll need the razor blade. They'll come shrink wrapped and because they'll be delivered to you via a tow truck or on a flatbed. Some of you will receive your equipment through a Connex container. And for those particular customers, I want to spend 2 minutes going over the way the equipment arrives and how you need to place it in this particular normal transport arrangement before we go any further. First thing you'll need to do is find your key. This key is stored in a lot of places. Some of them will be located right here, attached to the maintenance valve for your blower. Some of them will be located inside your storage container. Some of them will be attached to the engine. And I've even seen sometimes they're attached to the front of the radiator. So find your key, turn it on, and that will allow me to release the hydraulic pressure in the ERV. The ERV will not, for those customers with the container, the ERV will not be in this position. The normal position for the ERV when we ship in a Connex container, in order to provide the most room for loading and unloading out of a Connex container, is like this. And you're not gonna wanna transport it down the road like this. The end of the ERV relative to where the hitch is way too close. The ERV will be held in this position by a mechanical restraint which is bolted down to the trailer and will grab the arm right here. You're gonna wanna unbolt those components and dispose of them. You will no longer need them. Once you've removed those, then we can go ahead, turn your key switch on, turn the switch on the back of the control box on the ERV, press the green button, you'll hear the valving operate on the ERV. Hold the green button down, and that will release your hydraulics and allow me to do this easily. I bring this into the normal stowage position. This travel latch is most likely removed and sitting inside of your job box. So you'll want to bring that out and bolt that up. And then you could swing it up into position, and now your arm is in the typical storage position for transport, and like the remainder of video, how it's gonna be shown. So what I want to do first is give you a general arrangement of the entire system here. So as we get into the various aspects and sub-assemblies of the piece of equipment, you'll have a point of reference and you'll be able to understand how it ties into the other components on this trailer. Everything designed on this particular trailer is set up for the efficiency of a 1 to 2 man work crew, as well as the safety of that work crew. You'll notice the interfaces and the equipment are all gonna be accessible from the curb side, the right-hand side of the trailer, or the rear. Very seldom will you ever need to go onto the street side or the traffic side of the trailer when you're out there doing your normal PMs on your valves. So let's start up here in the very front. The trailer is available as either a pintle or a 2 5/16 ball. You have your battery disconnect. You have your harness storage receptacle. Sliding back even further, you have a hydraulic breaker mount for a 45 pound hydraulic breaker that would go here. You have a low point drain for your main water tank. The fuel cell, whether it be for gasoline or diesel, is located here. You'll notice the main water tank. It holds about 90 gallons of fresh water. We go to the job box. It's an polished aluminum diamond plate job box. This is part of the LX package. So if you don't get the LX package, this will not be here. Main power pack. This is obviously a gasoline version, but the difference between the gas and the diesel are very minor except for the engine. You'll have your control panel. which will give you the interface for all the various functions, gauges that show you the condition of the vacuum and your charging system, your tachometer and your hour meter located here. Located inside this will be your interface for your light bar. It'll be located inside there. That also is a LX feature. Your vacuum pump, your pressure washer pump, and your hydraulic pump are all driven off that common engine platform. Moving down, we have the hydraulic reservoir. There's two versions of this hydraulic reservoir. One of them has manual selector valves, and one of them has electronic selector valves. This is standard with the LX package. You have a 50-foot hydraulic hose reel. This is to run any type of Class 2 hydraulic tools, whether it be pipe cutters, whether it be dewatering pumps, whether it be the hydraulic breaker that I made mention of earlier, whether it be a handheld valve operator. All those types of hydraulic tools can all be run off of this circuit, changing up the valving on the front, and it diverts the oil from the valve machine to the auxiliary hose reel. Continue sliding back. The heart of any valve maintenance trailer is actually the valve machine. This particular, on the standard LX, you get the ERV 750, which gives you 13 feet of reach. It also gives you up to 750 pounds maximum output torque. Under the ERV and pinched between the fender and the spoils tank is an electric over hydraulic power unit. So separate from the hydraulic system that's built into the main power pack, you have a 12 volt DC power pack that runs all the necessary functions to dump your spoils tank and to open the rear door. That's located down here. Above that, you have your filter assembly for the vacuum system. There's two quarter turn latches on the backside. There's a canister located on the inside. And on the front are your vacuum reliefs to make sure that you don't exceed the rating of your vacuum pump. As we move around the back of the trailer, staying with the vacuum system for right now, some of the features you'll notice, you got a 3-inch vacuum hose. Depending on how you receive your unit, the vacuum hose may be coiled and sitting inside your tank. So that it might be located in there. You might not have it already attached to the arms. If you have to remove it from inside the tank, or even if it's already been installed on the tank, you want to make sure it's wrapped in this configuration. The hose interfaces with the tank input. Wrap it first over the lower right arm, and then continue in a clockwise fashion so that your wand holder makes it over the upper right arm. That way, you never have to worry about this jumping off and dragging on the ground behind you. The hose is secured with a couple of bungees. The bungees themselves have a hook on one side and a latch on the other. So you will undo them and leave them like that when you bring out the vacuum hose. Clip this back on. Sticking with the vacuum tank and kind of away from your view right now, on the bottom of the tank you have a 3-inch dewatering valve. This is primarily used if you've excavated or if you've dewatered a vault and you know it's mostly just fluids, rather than go back down the road and you want to go ahead and drain this, as long as your vacuum's turned off, you can go ahead and open this valve up and either run it through a hose or just let it pour out the valve. You cannot use it while the vacuum is running. Some vacuum systems allow you to dewater with the vacuum running. We cannot. On the top, you have a vacuum brake. So when you're vacuuming a valve box and you pull up a rock or you pull up a pop can, when you bring it to the top, you have 11 inches of mercury up against there. It's very hard to get that rock off the bottom with your foot when you're holding the wand. So if your partner opens the vacuum brake, then that suction between the debris and the wand just disappears and that piece falls off. You go back to work, he closes the vacuum brake, and you have vacuum in your line again. At the top of the spoils tank, we have a service light bar on there. This is standard with the LX package. It's included. If you do not get the LX package, that's an option. You have two work lights, two LED work lights, which swivel and tilt. And then you have a arrow board on the top, which is also LED, and that's controlled through a interface inside of the control panel. So you'll want to open up the control panel. Your key or a coin, quarters work pretty good, goes inside the latch and opens the door, and you have access to that then. The trailer that this is sitting on is all LEDs as well. You have indicator lights down, a pair of them on each side in the back. You also have LED indicators on the side. You also have an LED light that serves to light up your registration tag. Moving around the back to the corner over here, we have a 50-foot pressure washer hose reel. This is currently attached to the recirc line. So if you do live in the colder weather climate and freezing is a problem and you still want to be able to do some hydroexcavation work, with your main tank filled with water, you'll leave the engine just idling. You'll have the selector valve set to the hydraulic to the pressure washer pump, and water will run from the main tank up through your pump, through the pressure washer reel, and then back to the main tank. So it'll continue flowing, and you won't have to worry about freezing while you're out during the day. Here we have storage for all of the washer wands, the telescoping key, as well as your vacuum wands. Your vacuum wands, the valve maintenance system comes with three of them, ranging in size from 2.5 inch, which is the standard one you'll use during hydroexcavation, to a very small key holing one, which is 7/8. A lot of times this is used if you're going to be using a the valve nut RX or some other type, or if you need to do some very fine material removal and need to get around the side of the nut or the bottom of the nut, you'll be using this very small one. Your telescoping valve key. This is the North American one and the standard one that's part of the kit. It has a range from 4 feet to 9 feet. We also offer a warmer weather climate one, which goes from 3 feet to 8 feet. So that's three pieces make up that total length. With either one of the keys, you can continue adding middle sections and add 3 feet to your reach every time. So if you have the North American one that goes from 4 feet to 9 feet, you add another 3 foot section, and now you can go from 4 feet to 12 feet or 4 feet to 15 feet. And it just keeps going on and on as you add those 3 foot sections. You have two pressure washer wands. You have a long wand, which is for doing the digging. This is your digging wand. Okay, it's got a tip on it that you can rotate 180 degrees, and it'll go from a fine pinpoint to a fan point. Do not use this for cleaning your equipment. This will take the paint off. For cleaning your equipment, we have a short wand, far easier to handle. This will create a spinning type of motion on the tip. It's very soft. You're not going to do any damage with this. It's great for cleaning your equipment, cleaning the inside of your spoils tank, making sure that the equipment looks as good as it performs at all times. As we move around this side of the trailer here, as we're working our way to the front again, as mentioned, there's really not much on this side that you're going to be needing to deal with as you're out there doing your PMs on your valves. But I wanted to make you aware of it in the event you're asked to reference back to it. Right here you have your 12-volt closed cell battery. This is what provides power to the engine, the lights, the hydraulic valving. Those are all draw power from this 12-volt source right here. We move forward. You have a prime tank. This is a prime and winterizing tank on the top here, and you have your main water tank, and the pressure washer pump decides which water it's taking by this three-way valve here. This pulls water from the charge tank. This pulls water from the main tank. This is the condition it'll most normally be in. But what can happen when you're out in the field is no one's watching the water level, and you suck this all the way dry, and now you've got air in your system, and it's very difficult to get a prime. Built into this is a flow switch, so you don't burn your your pressure washer pump up by running it dry. If it doesn't see water flowing for more than 7 seconds, it shuts off the clutch that runs this pump. So when that happens, what you're going to need to do is fill this with fluid, run over to your charge tank, and then start. This is at a very high elevation, so it doesn't need vacuum to pull the water up to the pump. It'll use gravity to supply water to the pump, and it will start charging the pump. It'll get it wet. It'll allow it to be more efficient. So you'll flip it over, water will start flowing out of your pressure washer line, and then you'll flip it back to main tank. And you might have to do this several times in order for a good charge to take place, and you've pulled all the air out of it. All right, that's only required if you run this thing dry, that you have to keep priming that, or if you haven't used it in a long time and eventually it drains back down into the tank. Right next to the three-way valve is an unloader valve. This helps you lower the amount of pressure. Normal output out of this pump is 3,000 PSI. Suppose you're doing something else with your water system, like maybe supplying water to a pipe cutter or something along that lines, and you don't want all that pressure. Use your unloader valve, you back this thing out, and you can really reduce the amount of water going, the amount of pressure going to that that apparatus. What you'll notice with both of these tanks is there's pink fluid in here. So from an operational standpoint, we ship both of those with an RV or a marine, an environmentally friendly water-based antifreeze in both of these tanks. In real world situations, you'll just fill this with potable water. That's what you're normally going to have inside this tank. What you're going to want to do though, because this is a clear tank so you can see the water level, you're going to want to periodically maybe put some bleach in there. Otherwise you'll end up with biologicals growing inside there, and that becomes a problem for the pump system. You'll end up plugging that up. So when you receive this, go ahead and put fresh water in there, and then periodically put some bleach in there to make sure you don't get growth. If I had this tank full, I'd probably put a half a cup of bleach in there. That's all that's required. And then, although we mentioned in the beginning of the video, once again right there is your low point drain. So when we talk later about winterizing, you want to make sure you reference that low point drain. Okay, now there's still a lot of items that need to be introduced into the equipment in order to make it ready for field use. Those will be stored in your job box if you have the LX package, or it may be stored in a cardboard box, and you're going to have to unpack those items. The first one will be your swivel socket. That's located inside the box. We're going to go bring it back to the ERV because this is where it will stay for the remainder of its life. Remove the quick pin off the top and the rubber gasket. Install the swivel socket from the bottom up. Install your rubber gasket and then the quick pin. And that's the way it will be from here on out. What this swivel socket provides for you is 30 degrees of misalignment between the machine and your telescoping valve key, as well as gives you all the adjustability you'll need to take into account the differences between the indexes on your telescoping valve key. So a telescoping valve key can only go into fixed increments. This provides the additional adjustment that you need. You have a drain hose here. We'll cover this later when we get into maintenance, but there's a port on the block of the engine that you'd plug this into, and when it's time to do your scheduled maintenance to change the oil on your engine, this allows you to not make a mess all over your power pack. You have a plug for your spoils tank. Right now the hose is always attached to the spoils tank, but if your spoils tank was full of some material that you need to transport to a site, instead of having every time you accelerate and decelerate, having that fluid try and rush out the back of your hose, you can disconnect, remove the clamp off the back of the spoils tank, remove the hose, put this plug in there and put your clamp back on, and now you don't have to worry about your tank discharging as you're traveling down the road. You also have your manuals in here. There are several manuals that are included. You'll have one that covers all the major subsystems of this particular trailer. You'll have a manual in here that deals specifically with your valve machine. Those are all located in here, as well as specific manuals that relate to the engine, the particular engine of your unit, the various pumps that are included with your unit. All those individual manuals are located inside this clear package as well. And then you have the brains of your equipment, which is your HC100 handheld controller and data logger. In the top, when I open this up, you'll find a quick setup guide for your HC100. There will be a screen protector for your HC100. There's the content guide. There's also, if you have the LX package, there's a setup guide for the Bluetooth adapter. What we've done for the purposes of this video is there's also a manual that's available for download on our webpage that deals with the software. Software manual is pretty large and it changes pretty often. So instead of including it with the equipment, it is something that you will need to download and print off if you need a copy of it. When we dig into what's included inside this box here, you have a control cable. This control cable is the most reliable way for your HD100 to communicate with your valve machine. Although this does have a Bluetooth tether, which is great, those of us that have cell phones and pairing with your car know that there's times when it doesn't always work reliably. And in the event of emergency, you always need a way to communicate and have your machine operate properly. So a hard connection is the most reliable way to go. It's also, if you're having problems with your equipment and you want to talk to someone in tech support, they're going to ask you to use a hard cable. All right. So that's included in here. You have your HD100. These typically come somewhat charged depending on how long it's been on the shelf. So the first thing you do before you go out in the field is make sure you charge this up. Under the HD100, you have a DC charge cable. It's 12 volt, plugs into your cigarette lighter, and it's got an interface to charge up your unit. You have a USB to micro USB adapter cable. This is how the HD100 communicates with your computer. So when you're downloading the information from this device onto the Vitals office or desktop software, you'll need to use this particular connection cable. You have an AC charge adapter. This is 110 or 220, 50 hertz or 60 hertz. There are a little bag that has all the various adapters for the front of this charge cable. So you'll want to remove the clip and grab the one that's appropriate for your network and attach it to this AC adapter and charge that up. You also have a capacitive touch stylus, as well as a screwdriver to change the battery. On the back, it's a lithium ion battery. Will probably last as long as the device does itself, but it does include that in this kit. So those of you with the standard LX, with the LX package, you're gonna have this hydraulic hose reel. It ships with the hose really, really far, the ends of the hose really, really far away from the stop ball. And you don't wanna be caught driving down the road with it looking like that. So this is the reason why you need the Phillips screwdriver. We're gonna go ahead and loosen that one. And then loosen this one. And then slide the ball down, leaving probably 12 inches from the end of your quick disconnects to the ball. Tighten it back up again. And that's the way it'll remain from now on. Now, there's a couple of the other items we need to take care of here to make sure that they're functioning properly. And fit, we're gonna wanna take our telescoping valve key out, and reason for the razor blade again. This is gonna arrive, all three pieces are together like this. I'm gonna wanna remove this, and remove this. All right. Most valves you're going to find here's your three pieces. This is the piece I was referencing earlier that you can continue to make your key assembly much longer. This is 3 foot extension and you can keep stacking them on top of each other. You plug that end into this one and you would keep going. This is what gives you the fine adjustment right here. This is how you would normally have your assembly. Certainly the farther north you go, your infrastructure is going to be a little bit deeper. And you can see there's the release pin, and I can go up and down. You're going to want to check to make sure that each one of these works properly. The other thing you'll want to check with this before you go out in the field is that this end interfaces with your universal socket. So just to verify that, I'll go ahead and make sure these pieces fit together properly. And it does. So that's just one more check you want to do before you go out in the field. Along that same lines, I'm going to also want to make sure that my vacuum wand holder and my vacuum wands also interface properly together. And for that, I will need the help of an assistant here. First thing I'm going to want to do is remove my vacuum hose. Sherry, my assistant, is going to remove one of the wands. You'll want to do this for all three of your wands. It's pretty difficult to try and do this test by yourself just because the hose is kind of unwieldy. So I'm going to go ahead and hold the wand holder and pull the release pin. And we're going to check this with each of your wands to make sure they properly fit and that they latch properly. Go ahead. Sorry, I didn't pull the pin properly. All right. So, yeah, you'll want to do that with each one of your three different wands to make sure those all fit properly. A pro tip here, when this ships, this will be very dry on the inside. It'll be, you know, cold rolled steel. There may be even a little bit of surface oxidation. That's the reason I got the WD-40 right here. You spray a little WD-40 around the inside of this, also around your quick pin, and maybe even some around this powder coated surface, and the pieces will slide together real easy and come apart real easily. So now we're getting ready to start this engine up and actually run all of these various systems. So we want to make sure that we have fluids in all of our mechanical systems. So here's your pressure washer pump right here. And on the back side here is a sight glass. And as long as your equipment is sitting on level ground, I'm not in a great situation right here out in the lot, but you want to make sure you're on level ground and check that the oil level, the bottom part is dark and the top part is going to be light. That'll be your air in the system. So this one looks good. I'm going to jump up on top here for a second and pull the engine dipstick. Depending on whether you have the gasoline or the diesel, you will have your dipstick in different location. So you'll pull this and also make sure that you have oil between the L and the F. As I'm on this side of the trailer, I'll make mention that you'll want to make sure you have fuel. The gasoline version, you have a sight glass on top of here that has your fuel gauge. On the diesel version, you do not have this. And that digital panel that I mentioned earlier, that'll contain your fuel level, and that'll be right on the control panel. So let's spin around here real quick. So on the vacuum pump itself, there are two sight glasses, one in the back half of the housing and one in the front half of the housing. You have a sight glass for each one of them. You'll want to make sure that you see oil in there and not clear, indicating you're low on oil. On the same side, we have one more oil level that we're going to want to maintain. That's for our hydraulic system. Now, depending on which version of this reservoir you have, the sight glasses are slightly different. The one that's got the electronic switching, you'll have a sight glass on the face of it, and it's a little bit easier to see. On the manual selector one, the temperature and oil level is located down inside here. So you gotta kind of look inside there and you'll see oil on the bottom. Also an indication of the quality of the oil. It should be a nice amber color. And then a small amount of air at the very top of that temperature gauge. So that'll serve two purposes. It'll tell you the temperature of your hydraulic system as well as show you the condition of the oil and the level of it. Okay, now's the fun part. Now we actually get to start operating these devices, making some noise, and seeing things move. What I want to start off with is the control panel right here. I want to show you before I turn anything on how to set your aero board, because as I mentioned earlier, the aero board controller is inside this box. So once I use my key switch, you can use a quarter. A quarter works just fine as long as it's a half round like this. It operates the lock. I open this up, and located right here is your aero board controller. You have the ability to bias your lights one way or the other, inside out. You can kind of choose that or the light intensity. Normally, I just leave it set from inside to out. I leave it set for brightest and just leave it like that. I never touch it again because I have the on the face of this control panel is where I turn it on and off. And then it'll just, whatever the program is set for is the way it's gonna run. So I take my key and I go ahead and turn it to the on position. And let's go over some of the things that you see here. On the gasoline version, it'll be slightly different than your diesel. You'll have a vacuum gauge. This vacuum gauge is normally when your vacuum filter is clean, you'll be running around 2 inches of mercury. As your vacuum filter gets dirty, you'll start seeing, even though you're not doing anything, it's so difficult to pull the air through that filter that you'll start seeing this climb to 6 inches of mercury, and you know your filter is dirty. You've got a voltmeter on here, and when it's not running, your voltmeter should be down around 12 volts. As soon as I start this and give it some gas, this should climb to close to 14 volts. If it doesn't, then you've got an issue with your charging system. So those are both important gauges to have on there. Here is an hour meter, but as soon as the engine starts, it turns into a tachometer. Now, if you have a diesel unit, this stuff will, the voltmeter will be gone, your tach will be gone, and you'll have a digital display right here. And in addition to giving you those inputs, it'll also tell you your fuel level, your engine temperature, and some of those other items that you don't get with the gasoline version. We have a couple of switches down here that cover how the spoils tank is dumped. When you go to dump your spoils tank, one, make sure you're attached to a tow vehicle. I don't want you dumping your spoils tank without a tow vehicle on there. But I will demonstrate without dumping all the way, and I know my spoils tank is empty, so I'm pretty safe. I'm not going to create a safety issue. So the first thing you want to do is operate your slide function and your tip function, and then the door function secondarily. Because the spoils tank translates 12 inches before it lifts up and dumps to clear the back of the trailer, if you open the door first, you have a chance of taking some of your spoils and getting them all over your nice clean trailer. So let's go ahead and raise the tank slightly just so I can show you how it works. Here we go. We're gonna go up. It slides back. When it runs out of stroke, it'll kick up then. So I'll do it part way. It's about as far as I want to go without being attached to a vehicle. So that will go all the way up to a 60 degree angle to give you a real nice clean dump. And then your secondary one is the doors opening, and I can open that up as well in this position. I don't want to do it any further than that. I've unlatched the door. And if this tank was all the way up, that door would swing wide. So whenever you're testing this, make sure there's nobody behind you. When the tank is up and this door opens up, it swings way out. That's the condition you want to be in when you want to clean out the inside with your pressure washer cleaning wand. Reverse the process when you go back down again. I'll go ahead and go down. Return it to its home position. And I'll close the door. And that's it. That's the functions of your spoils tank control. Down here, we have all the two on the right control that service light package. Like I said, that's part of the LX. This will turn on your aero board based on how you have it programmed. And this will turn on your work lights. As mentioned, I like leaving these just in the inside-out position because I'm never sure if I'm going to be in the middle of the road, if I'm going to be off to the side of the road. This kind of covers all my base, telling you there's a warning there, and you don't have to worry about opening that door all the time. Your service lights, like I said, they pivot around, and there's not much adjustment for that other than making sure that it's aimed at your work site at night. Okay, the last selector switch that's on here controls all the various electromagnetic clutches that are attached to the motor. The hydraulic pump is directly coupled to the motor, so as soon as the engine's running, I have hydraulic flow. It's always going. But the water, the vacuum, and the combination water vacuum are all controlled through clutches. One thing I want to point out, like a clutch in a car, you always want to make sure you throttle down before you engage any of them. So so you can hear all those clutches engaging. If you have your engine wound up, because you're gonna do some vacuuming, and you hit vacuum, there's a good, I mean, that's just like dropping the clutch on a car. You tear those clutches up really, really badly. And you know, that will not be covered under warranty, unfortunately. So throttle down, engage your various system, and then throttle back up again. For valve exercising, like I said, the pump is directly coupled to the motor. Normally, 2,000 RPM, maybe around that range, is great for doing your valve exercising. But if you're running any Class 2 hydraulic tools, you're going to want to give them full power, because when the motor's running full RPM, that pump is delivering 8 gallons per minute at 2,000 PSI, which is what a Class 2 tool needs. So if you're running off of your hydraulic hose reel or off of the front service ports, if you don't have the LX package, then you're going to want to throttle all the way up. And that's what you'll use for pipe cutting, running breakers, running dewatering pumps and handheld tools and stuff like that. Those all be done with the throttle all the way up. When you're doing vacuuming, same situation. Click over to vacuum, throttle all the way up. You're going to want to make sure you have maximum maximum vacuum, which is about 550 CFM when this is all the way throttle all the way open, at about 12 to 13 inches of mercury. And then your water system, throttle all the way up, and that will give you the same. They'll give you 2.6 gallons per minute at 3,000 PSI. So those are the various functions that you'll see right here. At this point in time, I'm gonna go ahead and start the engine, and we're gonna go ahead and demonstrate some of the tests that you're gonna wanna do on each one of these. So it may be hard for you to hear me. I'll try and step away from the equipment as I perform these functions so that you can hear me over the engine. The bottom lever here is your choke. The top one is your throttle. To operate your throttle, you push the center button, and then you can pull and push. So like I said, anytime you're gonna wanna engage one of your clutches, this will be how you wanna have it. When I engage the vacuum, see how nice and easy that was on the system? There's the water. So we'll go ahead and do a vacuum test on this. What we're gonna wanna do when I throttle all the way up, you're gonna wanna check your vacuum gauge that it's down low. Then I'm gonna apply an obstruction to the airstream and make sure that the vacuum gauge comes up and it's giving me full pressure. In order to do this test, what I like doing is using this plug. So I'll go ahead and turn the vacuum on, start creating a little bit of a vacuum. You can kind of hear the air rushing right here, and I haven't even throttled up yet. So I'm just gonna use this plug. It doesn't seal perfectly, but it's enough for me to do a test. Now I'm gonna throttle all the way up, and we're gonna watch this vacuum gauge start coming up. It'll eventually reach a point where these valves right here will start letting fresh air in so that you don't exceed the rating of that blower. This cup, all I gotta do is use that vacuum brake. It's kind of what we talked about before. This vacuum holding something onto the end of my wand. If I use this vacuum brake, it comes right off. So that's kind of how the vacuum is going to work. I didn't get a complete clean seal, so I never came all the way up to the 11 or 12 inches of mercury on there. But you notice you start getting some of your vacuum relief valves started fluttering. They were starting to think, you know, okay, I'm getting close to wanting to open up at that point. I turn my vacuum off. I go ahead and move over to the water. Because the quick disconnect that's on the water line is open, it does not seal. You're gonna wanna hook up your pressure washer hose first before you select it on. Otherwise, you'll end up with a fountain coming out of your hose. So for the point of this demonstration, I'll use the clean wand. I'll take a little bit of payout here. I'll leave this on the ground. And you can go ahead and stay there. I'll go ahead and switch it over and throttle up, and we can demonstrate that. I switch over to water. I throttle up. So that's all there is to that. I'll go ahead and throttle down. And now I'll run the vacuum and the pressure washer in combination. It's merely a check to make sure that the control panel is functioning properly. So now I'll switch over to vacuum and water, and I'll throttle up. I'm not using the plug right now, but you can hear it and you can feel it that you've got vacuum there. And I also want to make sure I have water. So we know that that works. I'll go back over here and throttle down again. So we've tested two of the systems in our power pack, the vacuum and the pressure washer. Now the third system that's on there is our hydraulic system. Before you disconnect this, drop your pressure. I couple that back up. And bring my hose reel back. So now the only system we have left to test is our hydraulic system, which runs our valve machine, but it also runs our auxiliary tool circuit. This can run the valve machine, that's the way it's normally set up when the valves are like this, or it can run either through the front quick disconnects, or if you have the LX package, it can run through a 50-foot hydraulic hose reel. You're gonna wanna test your hydraulic system. I'll be able to test the one circuit on the machine, but you also wanna make sure that the machine, you normally aren't using full pressure. When you're running your Class 2 hydraulics, normally, if I had a submersible pump or a pipe cutter or something along that lines, I pull this out and I plug into it, and then I would test on another tool, but I don't have that right now. So all I can really do is deadhead the hydraulic system. So I'm going to change my selector valves so that my hydraulic system deadheads and I create maximum pressure. You'll see the pressure gauge here on the front, and I'm going to want it, when I deadhead it, that's going to go right up to 2000 PSI. And the machine will hold there. This is what controls between my ERV and the hose reel. So you see my pressure just jumped right up 2,000 PSI, you heard it. And now it's going back to the ERV again. This valve here selects between oil going to the front disconnects or oil going to this valve. So the hydraulic flow goes to this valve, then to either these ports or down to this one, then from this one to either the hose or the machine. So if you have a situation where you're out there and the machine's not working at all, check this valve, it might be in the wrong position, all right? Or this valve may be in the wrong position. When the machine's just idling, notice my pressure. There's no back pressure on my system. So now when I give it a little gas, I'm gonna flip the other one. And now I sent oil to these two. Pushing it back in again, the oil goes to the second valve and then to either here or here. That's pretty much that. If by accident you have, these are charged right now. a lot of pressure in here. You will not be able to now connect up a tool. It takes a while for this pressure to bleed back into the system and there to be no pressure on here. If this happens to you, the easiest way, if you need to plug a tool in, is to grab a couple of crescent wrenches and just break this free a little bit and let that pressure come out so that you can plug your quick disconnects in. All right, I've pretty much shown you everything on the rest of the equipment as far as systems are concerned, except for the best part, which is this valve machine. So what I'm gonna wanna do next, like I mentioned, the hydraulic flow is always running through the valve machine when the valves are set that way. So what I'll go ahead and do is I'll remove the transport pin and the docking arm. I'll turn my machine on. There's a toggle switch right here. I lift up on it. If you look at the end of that toggle switch, there's a flashing red light. The flashing red strobe tells you it's a heartbeat. It tells you that the control board is working properly. There's a secondary strobe, and I'll go over that later. You'll get, right now you're just getting a slow pulsing strobe saying, yep, I'm working, everything's good. When you switch over to Bluetooth, there's also a communication strobe, so you'll get the slow strobe, and then you'll get a fast strobe. Slow strobe, fast strobe. Slow strobe, fast strobe. And that means not only is my brain working properly, but I can also communicate through a wireless connection. So that's the reason why the two different strobes that are on there. What I'm gonna go ahead and do now that those two restraints are removed, I press the green pin and it releases my hydraulic system. I push the green, I let go of it, and it locks my arm in place again. I have 270 degrees of motion. From that mounting point, I can come all the way up here, or I can spin 270 degrees around all the way into the middle of your intersection. This gives you approximately 10 feet. If it's not far enough, if I didn't get my parking job great, or I'm in an intersection and I've got a cluster of valves, and I need that extra reach, you loosen the knob on the side here. You disconnect the harness restraint, and then you pull this pin here. It gives me another 3 feet. I tighten myself back up again. And now I'm reaching all the way across the other side of the trailer to reaching those valves in the middle of the intersection. So I'll go ahead and retract this. Lock it back down again. Put my hose restraint on. And then we're gonna connect up our HD100. Now, if I didn't mention this earlier, make sure your HD100 is charged up before we get to this far. Since I'm not sure everybody has the LX package, we're gonna start with a basic cable connection. You have an RS-232 connection on the bottom, and I plug that into the bottom of my HD100. Spin my little thumb screws to secure it. And then at the back of the ERV head is a communication port. I go ahead and, I'm gonna turn the machine off while I do this. I go ahead and remove the cap for that communication port, and I plug in the other end of the cable. This is a keyed connection, and they always go, this elbow shape here goes down and slightly forward. And then you just tighten the ferrule. I drop this into the cradle. I turn my machine on. I turn my HD100 on. And when the HD100 comes on, It'll load right to the vital screen. This is a Windows mobile device, but it's set up by default to load this program when you turn it on. So, depending on which version of Vitals you have, the newer versions of Vitals are a blue screen, the older versions of Vitals are a red screen. So what I'm gonna wanna do first, I'm gonna wanna check communication to make sure my machine is communicating properly with the controller. I'll go right to controller. And sometimes, depending on how it was tested last, it'll look for a cable connection first. And at the very bottom of my screen, it says cable connection to ERV750. If I wasn't using the cable connection and I was on Bluetooth, that bar across the bottom would be blue and it would say Bluetooth connection to ERV750. So I'm looking at that and I'm gonna want to tap that bottom, and there's a whole series of numbers across the bottom. What I'm really doing here is I wanna check to make sure that nothing happened between the equipment when it left our shop and it made it out here into the field. Nothing got damaged, no wires got bent or broken, the transducers didn't get whacked. I'm looking for, you have a series of numbers across the bottom. You've got, and they're all separated by a comma. So the second position and the third position numbers are telling me what these transducers, there's two transducers on here, are telling the computer. Because there's no load on the equipment, the oil running through this is balanced on both sides of the motor. So they should both be reading within a point or two of each other. So right now mine's showing with the engine running, I'm at 106 on one transducer and 107 on the other. That's perfect. As these transducers, because there's a micro thin piece of metal in there and it flexes as it senses pressure, that metal stretches over time and then it eventually wears out. So the computer is designed to look for values that are outside of design specification. So if you turn this on and it says you have a transducer error, chances are click this bottom bar right here and see what those numbers are. If while you're idling here, if you've got one number, let's say at 104, and then one number at 134, you know you've got a damaged transducer in there. There's tech guides that allow you, there's an adjustment to calibrate these things so they're spot on, but for the typical accuracy of this machine, which was within 5% of what its reading is, these numbers are absolutely perfect. So what I'm gonna do, now that I've checked my transducers by reading that, I'm gonna go back. I wanna check the encoder. So the two things that this machine's gonna wanna do is, it wants to know how much power am I putting out and how many turns have I applied. So I've just checked to make sure that the devices that read power are accurate. So I'm gonna go back from controller, I hit the back button in the lower left, I hit menu, and I delete activity. Yes, that'll take me back to the main screen. I'm gonna go to diagnostics right now, and that's where I'm gonna check the encoder. I hit diagnostics in the lower right-hand corner on this one. If you've got the red menu, you will have, it'll be vertical, and it'll be the bottom button. First thing it asks you is, make sure you read the manual. So you say, yes, I've read the manual. You click the little checkbox, hit okay. Now I've got a series of tests that I can do. One of the pro tips I tell people all the time, this button on top of here will eventually wear out on you. I can bypass that and go to brake, the very top selection. And I got a virtual brake now. So I can move my machine with my controller. So in the event you do have a compromised machine, you can still move it around, store it, whatever you need to do by accessing this virtual brake button. But what I'm really here to test is the counter. The counter is what's really important to me right now. I want to make sure that it's counting properly. So I click counter. It's the second option. And there's a right hand or a left hand test. What you have on here, if I remove this key, a lot of times there's already a red mark on the top of your machine. You can use that. You can use anything you want. All you're looking for is a point of reference. So for me, I'm just going to use this quick pin on here at the end of it. And when I hit start, it's going to make 5 full turns. And I want to make sure that pin stops within, you know, 10 degrees of my finger. So that's what we're gonna go ahead and do. Right now it's going right hand, and I'll hit run. So I'll just go ahead and count. There's one. Here's two. It's also telling you that on the picture here, it's telling me the number of turns I'm watching it. So it's telling me as it's counting. So here comes four. This will be five. And there, it stopped within the width of my finger, so that's good. I'll click from right hand to left hand, and then I'll do the same test, run. The position counter and the torque transducers are what help build that real accurate torque curve. You want to know at what point in time in the cycle of that valve did you encounter high torque or low torque. So this counter, perfect, right back to where my finger is. So now I know the encounter is working properly, and I know my pressure transducer is working properly. If, because during transport something happened and those don't work, there are tech support bulletins that help you adjust your counter or how to troubleshoot your transducers. So what I've showed you now is all a cable connection. What I want to also show you, if you have the LX packages, is how to verify your Bluetooth is working properly. So once I've exited out of diagnostics, I can go ahead and disconnect this cable here. Don't try and twist this whole thing. Loosen the ferrule and pull it straight out. Put your rain cap back on. And let's go ahead and launch vitals again. Because if you were in diagnostics last, when you exit out of it, it's a separate program, so it exits you all the way out. Now that I'm back in my vital screen, I'm gonna go once again to controller. And it's gonna say, oh, I tried to connect to the cable, but it's not working. Do you wanna auto connect? You say yes. Now, as long as the device has been properly paired before, the blue bar lights up across the bottom, and now it says Bluetooth connection to ERV750. So now I'm no longer straddled by my tether to the machine. I can walk around. The downside to doing this, great. If I'm in traffic and I'm in an unsafe situation, I can go inside the vehicle, I can go stand up on the curb. I got 30 feet of range where I can operate this machine and know exactly what's going on. The downside is when I tap the very top part of my controller to connect the GPS. If I'm moving around, I'm no longer getting accurate GPS points. So unless you have an external GPS, which we also have, which mounts right here, when you have that, then you can take your controller anywhere you want to go because your GPS is staying right over the valve. But if you're relying on the GPS fix on this device, the GPS antenna that's inside here, you've got to keep this by the machine. Okay, so now I can go ahead and normally the first step is you got your telescoping valve key in there and you need to get these two to align up. So I'm jogging, I'm turning right, or I'm turning left. You can hear the little beeping noise right now, which tells me I'm picking up GPS points. I've got 8 satellites in this particular location. So that's that little beeping noise you hear coming off the controller. So that's it as far as the functionality of your Bluetooth or your cabled connection. If you have problems with the Bluetooth because either you've got a new device, if the machine was tested with a different device than the one you received, any one of a number of reasons why the Bluetooth may not work the very first time out, there is the setup guide that comes inside your HC100 box. Pull that out and it walks you through step by step on how to properly pair this device to the ERV750. The number one maintenance issue that we find on the equipment is because the blower itself is cast iron on the internals, a lot of people will be vacuuming water and mixed water vaults, whether they're doing hydroexcavation or whether the vault's just full of water. So the airstream that makes it back to the blower is high humidity. So at the end of your shift, what you're gonna wanna do, and here's where your WD-40 comes in handy, is we have a, a, an injection port right here. Now this introduces WD-40 directly to the vacuum stream right as it goes into the blower. So at the end of your shift, if you've been vacuuming up high moisture vaults or doing potholing or line locating, we're gonna want to go ahead and introduce some oil. So what I'm gonna do is, I'm gonna start the engine again. I'm gonna start the engine again. Make sure my vacuum is open to the atmosphere so you don't have any plugging up your hose. I'm gonna throttle all the way, once I switch over to vacuum, I'm gonna throttle all the way up, and then I'm gonna open this port up. And as you open it up, you'll feel a small amount of vacuum by putting your thumb over it. And I'll go ahead and introduce WD-40, maybe 10 seconds of spray into that port, and let it run there for maybe 30 seconds. Let's go ahead and do that. For a little bit. A lot of times you can smell the WD-40 as it's coming out. I can smell it right now. So that's something that'll stop your blower from getting locked up. Should that ever happen, don't try to use the engine full throttle and drop the clutch. All you can do is tear up your clutch. The safest way to do that is to spin your silencer assembly off the top of it, take a penetrating lubricant, go ahead and spray the inside that that fitting. That'll lubricate the blower lobes and it'll lubricate the housing. And a lot of times you can use a soft drift to give it a couple of strikes, and that'll free those lobes up, and then you can use it again like normal. Don't try to use the clutch and the engine to free it up. The engine itself, the blower, and the pressure washer pump on the far side, those all have their own maintenance manuals. They're included in here. The oils have to be changed on a frequency, as well as the air filter for the engine. So make sure you monitor your number of hours and follow those recommendations so that you get long life out of that. As far as lubrication points on our equipment, these selector valves right here are in cast iron bodies, so they will eventually get stuck in some position. So a lot of times what you'll want to do with your WD-40 again is you'll spray where that spool runs in and out of that cast iron body, which is the little WD-40. Same with this one. And I'll work it back and forth. And that's it as far as maintenance required on your hydraulic reservoir. The ERV, we use calipers and disc brakes to secure the arm in place. These calipers float on caliper pins, and you can see each one of these, there's a little bit of lithium grease on these pins between the caliper body and those pins. So if you've got lithium grease, great. Go ahead and apply a little bit here and here and here and here. Same thing with the ones at the mounting pivot. There's four pins per pivot, so make sure you apply a little bit of grease. Or, once again, WD-40. Be very, very careful, though, that you do not get the lubricant onto your rotor. That'll mess up your pads, and then you end up having to replace those pads. There's a couple points back here on the ERV. The number one point you're gonna wanna hit are these pins. They do have a zinc plating on there, but over time, they will start to corrode. So a little bit of WD-40 on this. Same thing with your lock bolt here. The lock bolt is carbon steel with a black oxide finish, and it runs into a carbon steel. So there is virtually no rust protection on that. So definitely loosen this up a little bit, apply a little WD-40, and spin it back in. You're good to go. This traveling pin also can be a problem. It is a stainless steel pin and a stainless steel ball, but it's got a carbon steel spring inside there. Don't ask me why, it just does. So the little bit of rust that comes off that spring will cause this ball to kind of bind up a little bit. So I like to apply a little bit of WD-40 right to that. And it'll make inserting this pin and removing it much, much easier, so you're not busting your knuckles when you're trying to pull that out. So around the back of the unit, I also have a pin that you'll be using on a regular basis. Same thing, it is a zinc coating on there, and a little WD-40 on that will ensure that this continues to operate properly for years to come. While I'm back here, I want to adjust my filter. So you do have a pretty good indication when you see that pressure gauge, when I turn the vacuum on, and even though I'm not vacuuming anything or causing any obstruction, if that vacuum gauge is not down around 2 inches of mercury, then this filter is probably getting dirty. So you turn these, remove your lid. You have a single knob here. I go ahead and remove this. And you'll have a canister filter in here. These canister filters are washable, but you don't want to put a wet one back in your equipment. So I always recommend that you have two of these things. One that you have that's drying and clean, and one that's in your machine. So you've got a polyester sleeve over the outside of it, and then you can see the pleated filter on the inside. This can be washed with warm soap and water and then let to dry before we use them again. When you install this, there's a hanger on the back side of it, so it makes it real easy for you to apply this lid. So when you install it, it kind of lifts up on the back, and now it gets caught on that hanger so it doesn't fall out again. Put the cover back on and secure it in place. Cover goes back on. And lock it back in place. The spoils tank itself is the slide system and the pivot system. That's all. There is no bearing material in there. It's metal on metal. So you will have some grease points that you'll want to use a high pressure type of grease and a brush. I'll see if I can show that to you a little bit as I slide this tank back. You can kind of see down here, but you can see the joint between the spoils tank and the interim carriage. There's grease smeared all over that. So periodically you'll want to do the same thing. Apply a little bit of grease with a brush to that. The only item that should be touched that you're going to want to take a look at on a regular basis is your tire pressure on the trailers. Make sure that they're within the recommendations of the tire that's on there. So those of you in the northern climates that have to deal with freezing temperatures, if you are running fresh water in your system, we got to make sure that we winterize the entire system. So the first thing you're going to want to do is drain out your fresh water out of here, and that's done through this valve right down here. It's also a great place to wash your hands if you have fresh water. Keep a little soap in your job box and then rinse your hands there when you're out there. And then the charge tank is also your antifreeze tank. So we will fill this with about 3 gallons of RV antifreeze, which is that pink stuff. We have it in both tanks right now because we just never know when this equipment, what time of year it'll be shipping out. But for you out there in the field, this will be antifreeze. This is fresh water. What I'm gonna do, I'll go ahead and I'll disconnect my water pressure line from the recirc. And so that we can see this, you can leave it attached to this and you'll be able to see the antifreeze run into there. But because I've already have antifreeze in there, the only way for me to show you what's going on is to hold this in my hand. I'll open up the main tank, and when I begin the process, I'll lift this up. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna leave this over on antifreeze charge. You'll see this start running down. I'll just start the engine and let it idle, switch it over to water, and then this three-way valve is gonna pull the fluid out of here, run it through my system here, run it back to the pump, from the pump all the way down through my hose reel, from the hose reel, back up the line, and down into this main tank. So the entire system then has antifreeze that came from here and run through to the main tank. So that's the way you're gonna want to winterize. It's very quick, very easy. So let me go ahead and start that engine, switch that over, and I'll lift that hose up so you can see, and we'll watch that level come down. So you can see antifreeze running out, and we'll watch this level go down. The faster the engine was running, the faster this level would go down. So if you were running water, let me go ahead and shut this off then. If your system was full of potable water, what we would have is a situation where you'd be watching this and it'd be nothing but clear water coming out. But then as soon as it starts going to pink, that means you've purged the entire system and you've got nothing but antifreeze now running and you're good to go. I would still go ahead then, because if you've had a lot of fresh water that was in the system, that will now be in here before the pink starts coming out, and I would drain that out again. One thing missed when we were doing our orientation out in the lot was the series of labels that are located here on the side of the power pack. These labels serve as reminders to a lot of the important aspects of the trailer, whether it be safety, whether it be maintenance, or whether it be loading of your trailer. They're by no means meant to supersede the information contained in your manual, but they are a quick reference and something you should be made aware of. So now that you've got familiarity with the equipment and how it should perform, if something doesn't and it's outside specification, or if you're missing something, we prominently post turnvalves.com on here. That should be your first place to go visit. There you'll find copies of manuals. You'll find a community forum area where we have lively conversations about the equipment. We have user guides and tech bulletins located there. You'll find a map with the contact information for a representative in your area. Thanks for watching.